We were in a council meeting recently, and we were working on what are we going to focus on in the year 2015 in the preparation of our annual budgets and our business plans. And we luckily typically get at certain junctures in activities like that feedback from the masters, especially Lanello and El Morya, who come to our council and guidance committee meetings and chime in, and it's great. It's wonderful. We were discussing a whole kind of a laundry list of things that people know about that would be smart, good things to do, and we all kind of knew that there was probably a longer list than we should have there. And the master chimed in and said, choose those things which anchor the most light. And it was really a great breakthrough for all of us, because there was definitely things on there that on a variable scale that anchor more light, and other things probably don't. They're good things, but I think I took that as an admonition from the master that right now the earth needs light. And obviously that's not late breaking news. We know that, right? When there's a lot of karma coming down and a lot of fear, and there's a lot of changes in the earth, light is the antidote, right? Light is the antidote. So choose to anchor more light, the most light. Choose those things which anchor the most light. So I was thinking this morning, what could I talk about? And this popped into my mind, and I had the thought that, you know, we're right now doing one of the primary things that we do each day in anchoring light, which is this doing our morning service, our rosary service, our prayers, our songs, and that's obviously one of the most obvious part of that. But it popped into my mind also that there is, as in nature and all of life, there is this twofold action to anything like that. And anchoring light can have a more alpha thrust and a more omega or passive component to it. So what is that? Well, I think for me, at least, what it is it's what we do as far as passively emanating light throughout the day when we're not praying, we're not singing, when we're trying to actually just get along with our life, but we are perhaps providing a better or maybe a not so good vehicle for our own I Am presence to radiate through us and anchor light, or for a master to come along and who requires an anchor right there in the state of Delaware or wherever you are to pour light into to balance the equation. And we've heard this, that the masters do this, and you know, that's an interesting concept, that the masters use us to anchor light. And first of all, when you say anchor light, what does that mean? Well, because the masters, they have all this light, can't they just anchor it wherever they want, anytime, right? Well, I believe that it's extra work for them to do it alone. And because when you wish to transfer electronic light into the physical matter planes of the physical, mental, emotional, etheric, you have to have an anchor point there. And I believe that when El Morya decides that he needs to anchor some light in a place, in a geographical location, he either uses one of us because we happen to be near there, because we have matter in the physical plane. We have astral matter, emotional matter, mental matter, etheric matter here, and that light has a conduit then, and he can directly use that. If he doesn't have one, what he's got to do, I think, is to create a point there by projecting a part of himself there and then coalescing some physical atoms on various levels, and from there he can transfer light. And that's a lot of extra work. I mean, I actually feel that this is true, what I'm saying, and that's extra work. And they, as masters of energy and economy, would rather not do that because it's extra time and it's extra energy, and they'd like to have the greatest efficiency. So to the extent that we are available to be that conduit, we are a helpmate to the masters, right? And not only the masters, the Elohim, the angels, our own I Am presence at any given time in conjunction with working with the masters could do that from our own causal body. So this is something that we all know about a little bit, but and we kind of imagine that it happens, but to what degree does it happen? How good am I at this? At 3 p.m., I've been in three straight one-hour-long meetings, and you know, the day's kind of wearing on me a little bit. Well, how good am I if El Morya needs me right then? See, that's what I'm actually bringing up. I think that depending on our discipline at certain things and our attention on this whole topic, we can greatly change our efficacy and our efficiency and our usefulness to the Master and God Almighty at being a conduit for this light, being anchoring light right there. And I'd like to talk about some of the elements that can actually make a difference and make you, me, all of us, each one of us, better or worse, and how we can overcome the things that make us not so good and which kind of torpedo and sabotage this, and what we could do instead. And this is all things that I've kind of learned by studying this myself and caring a lot and just trying to make myself better. So I'm only sharing things really what I've discovered myself, not just book learning. What I've found is that if I attempt to make a habit of checking on myself very frequently throughout the day and looking at what emotions are happening and what thoughts are happening inside me, that's a key. That's a key. And in the absence of having the habit of checking on these things, what I think happens to all of us is that our mental bodies especially, but our emotional bodies, they kind of get this little movie going, this little thing going, and they play it by themselves, and we're working away. And I found that, you know, by doing this discipline of just maybe reminding myself very frequently, watch what's going on and what you're emanating, I found, obviously, that I'm sitting there and I'm thinking about some person that I'm not kind of totally happy about having to work with, or I'm thinking about money problems, or I'm thinking about some kind of job I've got to do that is kind of weighing on me, or maybe a laundry list of things that I haven't quite defined and it's kind of weighing on me, and those things revolve, and that's the saboteur. That's the thing that takes us away from being a good conduit for this light, because when we're rotating and revolving these things, what I see for myself is that for my soul, I'm just sitting there kind of like this, and there's drool coming right through here, you know? And I'm just sitting there as a soul, and I'm kind of watching this like a movie. And what's going around and around is this thing about that person said that, and you know, that wasn't right, and I think that I was right about that, and this little revolving movie reel about how somebody did something wrong, or even fear about what's happening in the news that day or whatever. It's actually something that's playing automatically, and what, it's not so automatic, it's actually your mental body and your emotional body kind of as a separate entity. You know, when we talk about who are we? And the masters have used the phrase our many selves. Well, what are these many selves? Okay, there's a soul and it's just me. Well, no, actually, when you're in embodiment, there's all these parts of you. There's all these different parts. And there's a whole cast of characters just inside our own mental body. They're the personalities and that we sometimes take on, or the concerns we have and so forth, and they can kick up and they can start thinking about things, and then the emotional body kicks in and starts emanating stuff as a result of that. And when you find yourself thinking in a less than perfect way about other people or your finances or something like that, your aura looks It doesn't look that good. Let's just put it that way. There's colors that are coming out that are not what the master would like to add to the general situation in the earth. And so what happens is your crystal cord narrows down. There's less emanation just from your own I am presence because, you know, your higher self doesn't want to create more problems in the world and more karma for you, because that's what you're creating when you're ruminating about these things and churning out this brown and chartreuse crud, right? Nobody wants more of that. Your I am presence doesn't, the master doesn't. So the master elects to move on and do something else, or your I am presence emanates less and you're just not emanating. So that's the kind of like the worst case scenario. And you know, this is not to point fingers. We all do this, obviously. But this is, I believe, the crux of what the masters are saying when they're saying attain greater presence. Because when you're in presence, this is not happening. This thing, this revolving and this emanating these worries and concerns and things like that. So the trick is, how do you do that? And also a thought comes to mind. You know, in the Bible there's a verse that says, pray without ceasing. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm not sure exactly what all that means. But one thing that comes to mind is being in the mode where you are emanating in this passive way all through the day, or maybe a slightly active way, but still going about your business, going about your work, and still emanating great light, great light. I think that's partly what this passage is talking about, is pray without ceasing. It's being a conduit for the Lord all the time and taking care that you are in a position as a friend of God to be suitable for that emanation and that light to flow through you. How do we do this? Because obviously this is a trap that every single person on this planet does, right? Nobody excluded, except for maybe somebody like Babaji or somebody, you know, who actually he's ascended now, but an unascended true master probably has got to the point, otherwise they don't call him a master. How do you get to the point where you've turned around these kind of old habits? Because that's what it really comes down to. For me, I had to face this and I was thinking, how do you change this? And it came down to changing habits. Now, how do you change habits? Well, you replace it with something else, or at least you put your attention on it and you gradually and kindly guide yourself. And one way I've done is I've set up my goal to check on what am I emanating right now many, many times a day. And I you can do it by, first of all, I stop and I just do a gut check of what am I thinking about? What have I been thinking about for the last hour? And it's a dead giveaway if I've been thinking about somebody else, because usually it's not that you're hating them or anything like that, but you have some concern or something about something they said. And this is a classic trap of your mental, emotional body to just get you to start spinning on something like that. Thinking about a person, thinking about finances, thinking about the news, thinking about just something that's coming up. Okay, that's not in presence when you're thinking about the future. So you gradually begin to get into the habit of hour by hour, in a kindly way, assessing what it is you've been putting your attention on, and then if it's not the right thing, find a way to change it and put it on something else. I do that when I want to change a habit. I do this little trick. See, there's a rubber band on my arm, and I don't normally wear a rubber band on my arm, so when I put it on, I notice that it's on many times a day, and I make a pact with myself that anytime I remember, and I stop and I think, what have I been thinking about for the last 40 minutes? Uh-oh, I was thinking about this person. And then I choose to do something different, which is I send a kindly note to that person. If it's about my job, or if it's about something, money, or something that I, you know, there's something that I could actually take action on, I'll write down an action, something that I can do, and say, okay, this thing's bugging me about my bank account or something. I'm going to take action. Boop, 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 boop. I write it on my to-do list. It lets you let it go, and now I'm going to feel joy. And I replace it with a feeling of joy, and I let that clear color-wise and feeling-wise whatever was happening and make it that circular motion, which is very definite, stop, quiesce, stop doing that. And a lot of times, 15 seconds later, it tries to start up again. And you watch, nope, not going to do that. Nope, I'm going to take action. Nope, I'm back on joy. And you have to actually, it's like quieting a child or a little dog or something that's kind of too excited. When your mental and emotional bodies are in this state, and in fact, they actually sort of do have a mind of their own, in a sense. That I've thought often to myself that my mental body and my emotional body, etheric body, physical body, you know, we say we have a body elemental. Well, I think each one of those is like an elemental, and they actually are somewhat independent, but they work together. They're like a little pack of little dogs or something like that, and they work together, they share notes, and they try to get you to feed them. And when you're feeding them, that's the part you're trying to stop doing. That revolving, that's when you're feeding that. And what you're trying to do is stop feeding it and let emanation happen unimpeded. That's the game right there. And the more you play this game, I found, the more you become very sensitive to what's happening. Am I doing this or am I doing this? And I started by doing this long enough, I started to be a lot more sensitive to how, what quantity, what quality of what I was emanating. It was only then that I began to actually start to see and feel quantitatively, to some degree, what my emanation was. And then when you start to get to that point where you can feel whether you are emanating or you're not, it all becomes different in a lot better game. It helps you a lot when you get that sensitivity. And I only got that sensitivity when I started to play this game really, really seriously. So emanating and being training yourself to nip in the bud this thing about worrying and ruminating about things, and then replacing it with joy, is this game. And I've had a lot of fun with it, and I've been very blessed with it. And not only that, what happens is, from time to time, you will find something amazing happening. And it didn't occur to me at first what was going on, but I just feel like, wow, today is really, really going well. And then it occurs to you, a master happened to need you, and he or she is really radiating a lot of light through you. And this happens on our pilgrimages and so forth. But you begin to even be able to sense what it is that master is doing through you, and to some degree, and what they'd like to do, because to the extent that you understand that, you can actually help. You know, you can actually roll with the tide of the actual light engrams that they would like to amplify there, and you can combine then, and you're working together as one. So that's another level of this that comes about when you do things like this rubber band trick, and you actually really work on this methodically, is you start to become, in an ever-increasing way, you know, this the friend of God, the friend of the master, and you're really always there for them. And as soon as they need you, you start to get this, you feel this ray, and you go, okay, I'm ready. And you blank your mind, and you pay complete attention to what it is they want, and you can start to kind of harmonize and work with them right then. So these are some things that I'd like to just share with you. I know that a lot of you have experienced probably various parts of this yourself, so I'm preaching to the choir here, but I wanted to share some little practical tidbits that I've used to continue to sort of work on this. This is not, I regard this as something that it's an absolute lifelong endeavor. It's not something that I work on for a month and then I just move on. This has become all day, every day I do this, because the more I work on it, the better I get at it, and the rewards are very great, I feel, and it is being a friend of God. So thanks for listening to this. Do you have any comments or any questions, or what are your experiences in this respect? Maria's here, Maydell's here, and Ken is here. Ken would like to say something. Go ahead.
Well, I'm just, instead of the rubber band or along with the rubber band, I'm just thinking of how many people have smartphones at their side. And I know we've talked about this before, where there's certain apps that you can use. And as far as these reminders that you are talking about and encouraging us to use to observe what state we're in and whether we're emanating or not, I'm just thinking of all the folks that have smartphones and how they could actually find an app or use this as an additional help.
Yeah, a timer. You could just use the timer
prompt to prompt themselves or you know, just using the alarm. That's kind of what I was thinking of. And I agree. I think that just that little practical tip to kind of give you that little impetus or reminder helps you to stop and refocus.
Yeah.
Thank you for what you shared with us,
yeah.
Boyd.
Yeah, you're welcome. And I would add to what Ken said is that any kind of reminder, whatever it is, it just helps you remind you that you got a program going. That's how I see it. See, I think many of us all of us on the path, we've modified ourselves a lot. How are you today compared to how you were when you were 19, Ken? A lot different, right? You've modified a lot of things, and it's a lot of like being more methodical and efficient at doing that. That's how I see this. It's like it's behavior, personal habit modification, but doing it in a very smart way. And you know, it pays great dividends. We stop making a lot of bad karma by not doing this revolving and stuff, and instead we turn it around and we're suddenly emanating greater and greater and greater light by because we qualify ourselves as a more pure conductor. Yeah, Madel.
Well, my experience is that when I find myself having negative thoughts, then I immediately stop and think, well, this is not right. So I put my attention on my higher self, my divine self, and think of all the blessings that I have received and all the light that emanates from this mighty presence that will illuminate me. And that makes a complete change so that I get off that course of being negative. And it's very easy to fall into that. So I find it's very uplifting to immediately turn my course around and think of the higher things, the love of life, of nature, of God, and think of all the nice things of the people I know, and this makes a difference for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Maydell. My experience with this process is based on the third step of Marshall Rosenberg's nonviolent communication, where you focus on the need. And we're not supposed to say that in our community after the conscious language. I replace that word and by virtue. And virtue is light of God, one ray of God's light. And when I come across a moment that I'm frustrated or sad, by using these steps, I focus on what virtue is not met for me. And that is for me the trick to refocus on the light of God, and then the joy feeling will come depending on how quickly I can switch from my frustration to that virtue that is not met by whatever happened, by people or myself not doing something or did. It's a clear step for me, these four steps of Marshall Rosenberg, and the third step will do the trick in in transforming the go around process in your mind. So thank you.
So thanks, you guys, for sharing. I think it's really useful to compare tips, compare our experiences, compare our learnings, and learn from each other, because sometimes something that another person has kind of stumbled on is just the right thing that we need today. And that's the spirit of what I kind of wanted to bring up here today. And just in general, to suggest that we're always working on stuff, you know, and we always have projects going, and we can have a project like this, which is, I'm going to really upgrade my light anchoring ability in all the times when I'm not decreeing. That's really the definition of what I'm talking about, because if we're getting up and doing our prayers and our rosary and stuff, obviously we're anchoring great light, and we're really helping the brotherhood, helping ourselves, getting a good spin up. However, I just wanted to highlight this thing about, well, what about all the other hours? Because we can actually unravel all of that pretty fast if we fall into these bad habits, and how do we each individually find ways to continually upgrade that and to change our habits. So thanks for listening this morning. Thank you. I'd like to share, for anybody who's not on our chat, there was a lively discussion around this this little talk we had, and I'd like to share this with those who maybe aren't on the chat. Lisa Meekin says, great teaching. I use the rubber band method occasionally, yet I like how you explained it to stay in presence and to be there for God's work. Thank you, Lisa. Now, Aida says something first in Spanish, and I'm not going to even try to sound that out, but then she supplied, I think, an English translation. She says, when I feel something that is not divine in me as sadness, fear, I ran to my to grab my sword, Excalibur, and I invoke Astrea until I feel good. Then I feel the violet flame to transmute, and I call if something undo has left me. I'm not sure. That's a Spanish translation, so I'm not sure. I think we get the idea, though. Thank you, Aida. And then Tucker says, great reminder and clarification of the revolving part. Just this morning, I was concerned about all the things I had to get done before I go to work, and I was inspired to write them down in a simple list. Excellent job, Tucker. Gets it off your mind if it's in a list. When I did this, she says, I was freed from revolving this stuff and felt a whole lot better. It freed up energy to use for other things, like emanating. When you talked about that, it clarified for me that was what I did. Thanks. Yep, that's the idea, is to take it off the hands of the little puppy inside of you that's revolving it over and over. Lisa Meekin also says, I also like how you said that these little critters constantly want to be fed like puppies. Yes, I think they do. Very interesting concept. I agree, being out of presence is feeding the lower astral beings. Better to feed the fire of the sun. Yes, that's my point. Yep. And Lisa Meekin also said, I agree that sharing our inner workings is helpful for each other. Sometimes we may think we are off track, and then we find it is a natural stage of spiritual growth. I think that's true too, Lisa. You know, sometimes I feel directed by the masters to do a thing, and I won't even know exactly what it's for. And then maybe later on, I'll practice something else. And then they'll say, well, now put them together. And I'll go, oh, look at what that does. That's cool. Because I never would have thought of it mentally, humanly, you know. So, yeah, these little helpful practices are something that it's good to share. And then Aida says, we are gaining from the beginning. Yippee. And there's a guest on who says, thanks for expanding this to remind that we are conduits for light for the masters. Yep. All right. Well, I think that's all the chats, and I really appreciate all the wonderful sharing and the wonderful participation in this service. Thank you, ladies, for being here, and God bless you this day, and God bless the earth for what we've come together to do.